have Libby Scala, and she's presenting Livia, a one-woman play.
To be nominated for an Academy Award for Lilies of the Field is really lovely. I am Livia Scala, and I am particularly grateful to have had a part in this production because it proves, besides the fact that film made already more than four times what it actually cost, it proves that the public loves something that is clean and decent, but yet entertaining, and it gives me a wonderful opportunity to give. To give. Whether I win the Oscar or not, I am tremendously grateful for this step. I vowed to myself before I came to the United States of America, it is the only country in the world that would open its gates to us when we fled Hitler. Don't forget that. I promised inwardly and until very recently I never told anyone or mentioned it at all, that whatever will be in my power to do, I will do to express my gratitude to the United States. The first 25 years were not easy. I had to work in a factory, behind a machine, and as a bus boy, as a waitress, and so on. But all of these experiences taught me a greater understanding of people. I love people. I really love them. And to hear them coming out of the theater after they've seen Lilies of the Field and to say, oh, when I went in, I was so tired. But now I feel so good. I feel so good. It gives me tremendous satisfaction. All my life I wanted to be an actress, but I wouldn't dare tell my parents, because for them, acting is like prostitution. Yeah. How does one explain to the average person the power of theater to inspire, to transform life? The significance. Libby, darling, did you learn my monologue from Twelfth Night for the audition? Yes, I did, Grandmother. All right, let's hear it. I left no ring with her. What means this lady? Fortune forbid my outsider, not charmed her. She made good you. Oh, darling, I knew you didn't learn it. But I did, Grandmother. I learned every single word. Well, you don't know what to say. So it's nice. You don't know what you're talking about. This girl, Viola, she believes her brother is drowned. She is grieving. She is confused. She doesn't know why she has the ring. I will do the thoughts, you do the lines, one by one. All right. So, my brother is dead. I'm all alone in the world. I don't know what I do. I go to see this woman because I'm in love with this man, Rosino, who looks like a boy. Now, what is this ring? I don't understand. Go! I left no ring with her. What means this lady? Slightly better, slightly better. Now the next thought. Oh, no, don't tell me. It can't be true. I don't know this thing. No, it's not true. Don't go. Fortune forbid mine outside have not charmed her. Darling, you see, that know what it's like to go through something like Viola has. You don't know anyone. When you're stranded in a strange country, do you know what that's like? No, but I can imagine that's what we had to go through. When we came to the United States, I had to work in a factory day in, day out, the same movement over and over again. Do you know what that was like? After I had been a stage star in Vienna, the first woman architect in all of Austria, to that menial work. Now this girl, Viola, she had been a noble woman in her own country. Now she must subject herself to being a servant in order to survive. Without this servant comes at her, throws the ring down and spits at her practice. People practically spat on me. I left no ring with her. What means this name? Fortune forbids my outside have not charmed her. She made good view of me, indeed. So much that we thought her eye did lose her tongue, but she did speak in shouts, distracted. She thought we sure the cutting of a passion invited to this church messenger. Darling, you see, that is what it takes to work. You don't know what it is to have discipline. We're great about acting. I suggest that you be a sculptor. Yeah. Isabel, your nose is much too large for your face. It is? Yes, it's out of proportion with the other features. You should pinch the nose. That way it grows more narrow. Very gently like that. Now, you know, I know why your nose grew so big.
You do?
Yes, darling, it's because you picked it. You didn't know that I watched you when you were a little girl and that enlarges the nostrils. You see, pinching will work the reverse action as picking. At least it doesn't grow bigger.
But Grandmother, my nose was already big,
but darling, picking it does not help. Pinch the nose. Now, fortunately for you, the proportions in a woman's face do change as she grows older. You will find you look very different in your 20s than you do now. Thank God. Different in your 30s and so on, it's natural. But right now, darling, your nose is disproportionately large. But I do love that sweater you have on.
Oh, thank you, Grandmother.
It's a marvelous color. You know, I used to wear evening gowns in the edge of that color. It was beautiful on me with my strawberry blonde hair and my complexion. Darling, that color makes you look pale and washed out. It does? Yes, a young girl should wear bright colors, red, blue, pink, not olive drab like that. Why don't you give that sweater to me?
But Grandmother, this is my favorite sweater,
but darling, why? It doesn't look good on you, on me it would look good on the nose. about me and I'm wearing this sweater. If there was one thing that I could rescue from a burning building, it would be this sweater. If I were to die and appear to someone in a vision, it would be I would be wearing this sweater. This sweater and I are synonymous, although we are ridiculous. I am your grandmother, and I have given you so much. It's the least you can do to give me that sweater which is not flattering on you and would look good on me. Please ask for something else, grandmother. Do you love me? Of course I do. Well, okay, I'll give it to you under the condition that you leave it to me in your will. That's a good girl. If this is the first, I have something for you. Your sweater. I never wore it. You never wore it? I never did. Grandmother, do you remember the scene that occurred when I gave it to you? What scene? Well, you begged me for it. When I said that it was my favorite possession in the entire world, you said it looked marvelous on you and terrible on me, and if I loved you, I would give it to you. You don't remember? I said that the grandmother would say that to a granddaughter. Horrible. I feed myself. I really must watch my thinking. Grandmother, I'm coming to visit you Wednesday, so darling, don't bother. You want to be with your family, not an old lady, but you are my family. But I want to see where you live now, little darling. It's not a place for young people. I received your new photograph in the mail. With your letter. You have a very lovely face now. Thank you, Grandmother. You know, I always said you are a good writer. Write a part for me. Because Hollywood writers, they don't know what to do with an old woman with an accent. They think we love to scrub floors and have 10 children, but you could do something interesting, too. Time to help. Not too late.
That's the true story about my grandmother and me. And I typically do a Q&A after the show where we talk about the development process of writing a play. People can ask questions about the story. We can talk about all kinds of issues, history, family, relationships, etc. So just wanted to add that. Thanks so much.